Salam, Moors.
Salam.
Salam. Now under the influence of the Moorish Science Temple of America, Moorish Divine and National Movement, founded by the Prophet Noble Drew Ali in 1913 AD, Moorish Divine and National Movement was incorporated in 1916 AD. Redeemed man from the sinful and fallen stage of humanity back to its highest plane of life, the organization was started to make our members better citizens. And with that, we're going to commence the Moorish American prayer. All those who do not wish to participate may stay seated in solemn benediction. For all that do, we rise and we face the east. We rise with five fingers on the left, two fingers on the right. Repeat after Sister Monica Beck.
Islam. Allah, the Father of the universe.
Allah, the Father of the universe.
The Father of love.
Father of love.
Truth.
Peace.
Freedom.
And justice.
Allah is my protector.
My guide.
And my salvation.
By night.
And by day.
Through his holy prophet.
Drew Ali.
Amen.
Islam.
Clearness and power. Islam, we now have the reciting of one of the most powerful documents of all time, in these days of time. And that is our divine constitution and bylaws for the Moorish Science Temple of America. Act 1. The Grand Sheik and the Chairman of the Moorish Science Temple of America is empowered to make law and enforce laws with the assistance of the Prophet and the Grand Body of the Moorish Science Temple of America. Assistant Grand Sheik is to assist the Grand Sheik in all affairs if he lives according to love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice, and it is known before the members of the Moorish Science Temple of America. Act 2. All meetings are to be open and closed promptly according to the Circle 7 in love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. Friday is our holy day of rest, because on a Friday the first man was formed in flesh, and on a Friday the first man departed out of flesh and ascended into his Father God Allah. For that cause, Friday is the holy day for all Muslims all over the world. Act 3. Love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice must be proclaimed and practiced by all members of the Moorish Science Temple of America. No members are put in danger or accused falsely his brother or sister on any occasion at all that may harm his brother or sister, because Allah is love. Act 4. All members must preserve these holy and divine laws, and all members must obey the laws of the government. Because by being a Moorish American, you are a part and parcel of the government and must live the life accordingly. Act 5. This organization of the Moorish Science Temple of America is not to cause any confusion or to overthrow the laws and constitution of the said government, but to obey hereby. Act 6. With us, all members must proclaim their nationality, and we are teaching our people their nationality and their divine creed, that they may know that they are a part and parcel of this said government, and know that they are not Negroes, colored folks, black people, or Ethiopians, because these names were given to slaves by slaveholders in 1779, and lasted until 1865 during the time of slavery. But this is a new era of time now, and all men now must proclaim their free national name, to be recognized by the government in which they live and the nations of the earth. This is the reason why Allah, the great God of the universe, ordained Noble Drew Ali, the prophet, to redeem his people from the sinful ways. The Moorish Americans are the descendants of the ancient Moabites who inhabited the northwestern and the southwestern shores of Africa. Act 7. All members must promptly attend their meetings and become a part and parcel of all uplifting acts of the Moorish Science Temple of America. Members must pay their dues and keep in line with all necessities of the Moorish Science Temple of America. Then you are entitled to the name of faithful. Husband, you must support your wife and children. Wife, you must obey your husband and take care of your children and look after the duties of your household. Sons and daughters must obey father and mother and be industrious and become a part of the uplifting of fallen humanity. All Moorish Americans must keep their hearts and minds pure with love and their bodies clean with water. This divine covenant is from your holy prophet, Noble Drew Ali, through the guidance of his Father, God Allah. Islam?
Islam.
Moving right along. Now we're going to have questions and answers. And it may not be in order, so be ready. Who made you?
Allah.
Who is Allah?
Allah is the Father of the universe.
Can we see him?
No.
Where is the nearest place we can meet him?
In the heart.
Who is Noble Jor Ali?
He is Allah's prophet.
What is a prophet?
A prophet is the God of Allah manifesting in the flesh.
At times, who do we refer to as being the great God?
Allah.
Was man made in the image and the likeness of God Allah?
No, he's the shadow of our lower self, which will pass away.
Who made the devil?
Elohim.
Who is Elohim?
Elohim are the seven created spirits who created everything that was, is, and evermore to be.
What is the nationality of Ruth?
Ruth is the Moabitess.
Where is the Moroccan Empire?
Northwest of Mexico.
What is the modern name of a Mexican?
Africa.
What is our religion?
Islam.
What is Islam?
Islam is the religion of peace and the study of self and the study of nature.
It's a simple religion.
It's a very simple faith. What does it require?
Love others, thyself.
Obedience.
No. According to the lesson.
Peace with all things.
What does it require? Islam.
One to be consecrated to God.
That's true. But according to the lesson, Islam is a very simple faith. Right? What does it require according to the lesson?
Recognize man's duties towards God Allah.
Islam. And to what else? His fellow man. Islam, was you going to say anything different, Emmanuel? Islam, his fellow creatures. Islam. What is your nationality?
Islam.
American. Why are we Moorish Americans?
We are descendants of Moroccans and born in America.
Who was the founder of the Moorish Science Temple of America?
Noble Jor Ali.
What year was that formed?
1913 A.D.
And what is the object of that organization?
To make our members for humanity.
What was the object?
Uplifting fallen
humanity. No.
To make our members better citizens.
Islam, listen. The object of the organization is to make our members better citizens.
Islam.
Now, what is the purpose? Now is the uplift fallen humanity, Islam. Why did Allah send Jesus to the earth?
To save the Israelites from the iron and oppression of the Palestinian nation of Europe, who were governed a portion of Palestine at that time.
And who was Jesus?
Jesus was the prophet of Allah.
What is an angel?
Angel is the God of Allah manifested in the flesh.
What people represent the higher self?
The angels who protect the holy city of Mecca.
How many cells are there?
Two.
Name them?
Higher self and lower self.
So what people represent the lower self?
Those who are cast out of the holy city and those who accept their teachings.
What does the lower self breed?
Hatred, slander, lewdness, murder, theft, and everything that harms.
What does the 5 points represent?
Love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice.
How old is that flag?
It is over 50,000 years old.
What kind of flag is it?
It is a red flag with a 5-pointed green star in the center.
How long did he teach?
18 years.
And what did he teach?
That Allah and man is one.
That's true. That's true as well. That's true. And where did he teach?
In Africa and Europe.
Where's the Garden of Eden?
In the name of Canaan, in the city of Mecca.
What is the modern name of the Garden of Eden?
Mecca.
Where's our new Mecca?
Chicago.
Islam. Who are Adam and Eve?
They are the mothers and fathers of the human family, Asiatics and Muslims.
Where did they go?
They went into Asia.
What is the modern name given to their children?
Asiatics.
Are we Asiatics?
Yes,
we are.
Why?
Because we all have the same fathers and mothers.
Islam, good answer. Who is guarding the holy city today?
The angels.
And who do they keep away?
The unbelievers.
Islam. What is the modern name of the angels?
Asiatics.
What was the answer that the lower self gave to the higher self?
I am going to and from the earth, seeking why I may devour.
What is the devil's name?
Lower self.
What is the name of the person into whom Jesus was first reincarnated?
The Prophet Muhammad, the Conqueror.
Okay. Well, if he was the first, who was the last person to whom Jesus was reincarnated?
Prophet Ali.
Islam. And what year was he born?
1986.
Where?
In the state of North Carolina. Teach more.
Negro.
A name given to a river in West Africa by Moors because it contains black water.
In West Africa. So, Negro is a river in West Africa. Then what language were they speaking in West Africa?
Black.
What language is the word Negro?
It's Latin language.
Latin
language is the word Negro.
Islam.
It's a Latin word.
Spanish.
What does black water represent?
Stagnant.
Dead water.
Islam. So can life live in black water?
No.
So if black means death, and people are referred to or coined as black people, the question is there a life running through a form that's black?
No.
What does the phrase civil litter mortuus mean?
Dead in the eyes of the law.
Wow. Well, would you define the word white?
White means purity. Purity means God, and God means ruler of the land.
Name some of the marks that were put upon the Moors of Northwest by the European nations in 1774.
Negro, black, colored, Ethiopian.
And can man be any of these things?
No.
Can woman be any of these things?
No.
Can the Europeans be any of these things?
No.
Why?
Because man is made in the image and the likeness of God Almighty.
Islam. That will conclude the questionnaire, period.
Islam.
So we will now move into the next phase. You ready, Sheik?
Yes, sir.
We'll now move into the next phase of the meeting, which is referred to as Quran class. Islam?
Islam.
Yes, sir.
So confirm yourself to the questionnaire and allow Sheik Clifford to introduce you to the Prophet. Islam?
Islam.
Yes, sir.
Islam.
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 I rise to give praise to the great Father God Allah, orchestrator of all the seven planes of existence. I give honor to his blessed prophet Nubi Jali, founder of the Moorish Scientific America, aligned with the Moorish divine and national principles. I give honor to my grand sheik, Lord Nature El Bey. I give honor to chairwoman, Sheik Nika Ebenon Tuna Bey. I give honor to his members and his own staff. I give honor to those who are trying to get overstanding of what it is they were called to do. Islam.
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 Islam, Moors.
Islam.
How we doing today?
Blessed.
We truly should feel blessed today. Because we're in the Moorish Scientific America. Study yourself, Islam.
Islam.
Knowledge itself is the best teaching, Islam.
Islam.
So I just want to make a recap or go through a recap of what we've been studying for the past couple of weeks. Because they're very important. We're in society. And in society, we suffer because we don't have an understanding of what it is that we are called to do. We have started this particular subject matter in regards to chapter 35. And it says, the great God institutes the laws for the governments of the world. Grounded them in all his being, and each creature, by its nature, conforms to his will. Islam?
Islam.
That's chapter 35, verse 10. We have understand that the peace in society depends upon justice, for the happiness of the individual and the safe enjoyment of all our possessions. So in order for us to have peace in society, there must be justice. Has to be justice. And the highest form of justice in this land is the Constitution. Islam?
Islam.
So today we're going to go and we're going to see the beauty of what the Nubi Jali brought us. Because instruction on social duty, what's missing is the knowledge to do what we need to do. And the knowledge that we need to know this comes from inconsistency and instability in our social duty. We are inconsistent and we are unstable in the instructions on social duty. Why is that? We're going to find that out. Let's turn to chapter 41. And this chapter is instructions on inconstancy. And we're going to reflect this to chapter 35, because both of these deal with the nature of man. Chapter 41, verse 1. It says, nature urges thee into inconstancy. O man, therefore guard thyself at all times against it. I'm going to read that again. It says, nature urges thee to inconstancy. O man, therefore, guard thyself at all times against it. Now, what is this verse saying? It says, your nature directs you to inconsistency. O man, because man has what? Two selves. He has a higher self and a lower self. But it says, man's nature makes him go into inconstancy. Why is that? Now we read chapter 35, it says, the great God institutes the law of all the governments of the world. Grounded him in all his beings. It says, and each by its nature conforms to his will. Look at that word nature again. It says, each by its nature conforms to his will. So now we understand that based off what chapter 41 is saying, and based off what chapter 35 is saying, they're expressing two natures. Now, can anybody explain to me, based off those two chapters, what those two natures are that we're expressing? Go ahead, Moore. Islam. Beautiful. I was going to go into that, but I wanted to get it from the actual chapter. Because chapter 41 is talking about man's nature, right? It says man's nature is inconsistent. But according to chapter 35, the great God institutes the laws for the governments of the world. Rather than in all his being, each by his nature conforms to his will. We understand that the being that's speaking about in chapter 35 is of God's nature. Not man's nature, but God's nature, right? We have to really see this in order for you to get the understanding of where I'm trying to go with this. Because man has two selves, a higher self and a lower self. So now, if we understand that man has two selves and a higher self, we understand that the higher self and the lower self represents man's nature, and the other one represents God's nature. We understand that God's nature and man's nature is not the same. Because based off the nature of man having two selves, and being that he has a higher self and a lower self, there's a distinction that we have to make between the two. So now, when we go back into chapter 2, we understand that Jesus and John was educated by who? His mother, Mary and Elizabeth. We understand that the lesson that they received was from who? Elihu. Elihu was the teacher of Mary and Elizabeth. And what Elihu taught Mary and Elizabeth that was supposed to be taught to Jesus in the womb for the instructions of their manifestation here on the physical plane was supposed to be based off what? God's nature, not man's nature. Now we're going to see this. Let's read Elihu's lessons so we can have a clear conception of what he's talking about. Chapter 2, Moorish. And this lesson is based off the instability and inconstancy in our social duty. Chapter 2. Parts of chapter 3 in the Hebrew lesson. Verse 6. It says, the higher self is the human spirit clothed with the soul made in the form of Allah. Is it the lower self, the carnal self, the bodies of desires? It is a reflection of the higher self, distorted by the murky ethers of the flesh. It is that the lower self, the carnal self, the body of desires, is a reflection of the higher self, distorted by the murky ethers of the flesh. It is that the lower self is an illusion and will pass away. The higher self is Allah in man and will not pass away. The higher self is an embodiment of truth. The lower self is truth reversed, and so is falsehood manifested. Verse 10. The higher self is justice, mercy, love, and right. The lower self is what the higher self is not. So they make an distinction between the higher self and the lower self. They make an distinction between carnal man and God man. Verse 12. It says, the lower self is rich in promises, but poor in blessedness and peace. It offers pleasures, joys, and satisfying gain, but gives unrest, misery, and death. It gives men apples that are lovely to the eyes and pleasant to the smell. Their core are full of bitterness and gall. Verse 14, if you would ask me what to study, I would say yourselves. And when you will have studied them and then will ask me what to study next, I will reply, yourselves. Verse 15. He who knows well his lower self knows the illusions of the world, knows of the things that will pass away. And he who knows his higher self knows Allah, knows well the things that cannot pass away. Verse 16. Thrice blessed is the man who has made purity and love his very own. He has been ransomed from the pearls of the lower self and is himself his higher self. So when we read about chapter 41 and inconstancy, we understand that when you deal with inconstancy, you can't be dealing with your higher self. You have to be dealing with your lower self. And this is the reason why we have suffered in our instructions on social duty. Because chapter 43 on the insufficiency of knowledge says, how many evil have been committed because of the connivance of the law? How many crimes are decreed by the council? Why is this? Because our negligence and our instructions on social duty. We are inconstant in social duty. We are unstable in our instructions on social duty. So this is what Noble Jali did. He gave us the instructions on how to be constant, how to be stable. And the only way to do that is to have moral standings. Because the prophet said the problems of life is largely social and economic. And from a profound sense, they are moral and spiritual. So what does moral and spiritual represent? It represents those high standards. It represents one defending justice. Because the peace in society depends upon that. Now let's go and see the description of the inconstancy that our brothers and sisters suffer from day in, day out in chapter 41. It says, nature urges the inconstancy, O man. Therefore, guide thyself at all times against it. Now it says, thou art from the womb of thy mother, variousing and wavering. And from the loins of thy father inherit thou instability. How then shall thou be firm? How can we be strong? Because the prophet said, from the womb of our mother, we inherit our instability. Now, did Jesus inherit that instability? No. Was Jesus inconstant? No. Why? Because he received the instructions. He received the instructions that he needed to receive from his mother and from Mary and Elizabeth in the womb. So when they came to the age of accountability, they had a clear conception of what they were called to do. But understand that Jesus represents love and John represents purity. And how can you have love without purity? We understand that we have two selves, a higher self and a lower self. And we just read through the one-on-ones, what people represent the higher self. What people represent the lower self. So if the prophet told us in chapter 31 that the peace in society depends upon justice for the happiness of the individual and the safe enjoyment of our possessions, what are we doing? What are we doing? So we must understand that the prophet said that they who gave thee a body furnished it with weakness. He said, but he who gave thee a soul armed thee with resolution. So what does resolution mean, Moors? Islam.
Peace.
Islam. Any more definition? I need something to more. Go ahead, Sheik.
First our lives and I give praise to Allah. I give honor to the prophet of Ali. Resolution gives you a chance to fix it, to resolve it. The resolution, you now have a remedy to disarm the inconstancy. That's why he armed thee with resolution. Mm-hmm. You have free will. Mm-hmm. You have choice. You can fix it.
Mm-hmm. See, this is what John was demonstrating, his resolution. John had a clear conception that he was called to do. He was out there dealing with instructions on social duty. John was just sitting back because he had this understanding. He had to demonstrate it. Where was he? He was in the marketplaces. He was in the temples, arguing with the doctors of the laws, arguing with the whoremongers, extortioners, the thieves. So now the question becomes, what are we doing? Because we are inconsistent, so in order for us to find a resolution in our inconsistency, we must understand what the solution is. And that source is the law. Because chapter 35 says, the great God instituted the laws for the governments of the world, varying all these beings, and each by his nature conformance to his will. So you conform to the law of the great God, Islam. And man and God is one. So it means that chapter 29 says, thou art the favors of heaven, who thy sons are equal, has raised these in sovereign power to rule over thee. So remember the ends and the importance of thy station is far more than the. Remember the ends and importance of thy trust is far more than the height and the dignity of thy station. That means that whatever the trust that has been placed upon you, you must execute that under the principle of love, truth, peace, and justice. Because as we see in the representation of government today, we don't see that purity in love. Because once again, chapter 43 says, how many evils have been committed by the convenience of the law, and how many crimes committed by the decree of the council? This is the problem because they don't have any resolution. They don't have a resolution. They don't plan on having a resolution. Why? The prophet said it here in chapter 41, verse what is it, verse 6. He says, beware of the resolution and the intent of thy actions. Now, we just said resolution means what? To find the solution.
Right.
To resolve the problem. But he said, beware of the resolution and the intent of thy actions. Beware of the instability and the execution. So what is that telling you, Morris? That the solution or the solution that the people are executing has no remedy for it. There will be no remedy. Majority of your citizenship comes by way of the 14th Amendment. Right? And the 14th Amendment says you have the right to due process. Chapter 35 says the peace is before thy consider that once, when thy whole thy imperfections, announcing this goodness, O Son of Humanity, who honor thee with humanity, who place thee in society to receive and confer reciprocal help and mutual obligations, protect us from injuries, confidence in the pleasures of this life, all that thou owest to the sisters of others, and cannot enjoy them but within the bands of society. Right? The peace in society depends upon justice for the happiness of the individual and the safe enjoyment of all thy possessions. So keep thy hearts in moderation and let the hand of justice lead thee right. That's social duty. That's enforcing justice. Through what? God's law, not man's law, because man has two natures. And based on what chapter 43 is saying, they're dealing with their lower nature. And the so-called due process that we so-called saying we're receiving has no resolution in it. Because the laws that they created are resolutions. They're not going to give you any due process. They're not going to give you a solution. Why? Because you nickelback colored Ethiopians don't have a solution. You are a slave. You are property. So we've been fighting for due process. We've been fighting for this resolution since 1865. Have we received it? No. Why? Because there's no justice in the land. In order for there to be justice, there must be purity and love. How are you supposed to have love for the law if there's no purity for the law? And we see it in the representation of the magistrate and subject who we appointed. It says, is there anything more lovely in the reach of man? Is it not knowledge? But who is it that has it? The statesman claims he has it. The ruler came to praise of it and come to find out that the people possess it. See, this is why Jesus and John had a clear conception of what they were called to do. They were taught this information in the womb. The prophet said, from the womb of our mother, where we're embarrassing, wavering, and from the loins of our father, we inherited our instability. How can we be firm? He's telling you right there. The remedy for the days of the past, about the remedy of the day, all pivoting love. Love for humanity. The prophet loved humanity. He loved us so much that he was able to set himself beside and deal with the cares of the world. All right, it says, verse 6, beware of the resolution and intent of their action. Beware of the instability in the execution. So shall I triumph over two great things, or two great fountains of thy nation. Those two great fountains are inconsistency and instability. This is the reason why we fall as a nation. This is the reason why we suffer as a people. Because we don't know what we're supposed to be consistent to. We don't know what we're supposed to be stable in. Because everything that we're being taught to you, for those who are being taught from you, from the people who created these resolutions. They're not solutions. What the prophet said, they are irresolutions. So Nabi Ali said, there's only one way that you will receive that which was lost. And it only comes through the connection of the Moorish divine and national movement. Because Nabi Ali understand the importance of being who you say you are. Because right now, we're known as Negro blacks and colored and Ethiopians. Prophet said the word nickel deludes to the word nigger as in the Latin language. And he said those names have never been recognized by any true American citizen. So we're in America, like every other citizen, and if a man is born and raised and he fails to give his free national name, he is misused, imprisoned, exiled. So why do you think they just passed that unconstitutional legislative bill that was passed? Why? Because the people are not in their right self. They're not enforcing the Constitution, which protects you. But in order for you the Constitution to protect you, you must be in your proper self. Because the Constitution does not give any rights. It protects rights. What rights? The right that comes from your moral standings. which we call in the more assigned to America, religious aims and beliefs. Because we understand that within those religious aims and beliefs, based off that of the higher self and not the lower self, that promotes economic security. See, we ain't in this for money. We're not in this for self-gain. We're in this to restore humanity back to the highest principles of love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. This is the reason why we have an old-time religion, Islamism. We understand that when we define things according to knowledge, wisdom, understanding, we're going back to the way they did it back in the olden days. Because right now, the so-called definition that we're receiving from the so-called terminology that we're using today had gotten us in the trouble that we're in. The remedy for the days is the same as the remedy for the days of the past, all pivoting love, love for humanity. But we just read chapter 43 on the chapter on insufficiency of knowledge. And we've seen in that chapter what they so-called knowledge represent. But what did Jesus say about knowledge? He said knowledge is a system of the lower self, the power of a man, a lying man, and that lying man is one. He said, what is understanding? Understanding is the rock which man builds himself upon, the knowledge of ought and naught, of truth and falsehood. That's what understanding and wisdom is. But in order for you to understand those concepts, you must understand what man. What is man? Man is truth and falsehood. Man is truth and falsehood. They are conjoined them and they strive. Naught goes down and man as truth abides. Because man is receiving that truth from the womb. On the principles of love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice, which are already expressed in the Constitution. Because when those people came together and drafted that beautiful document, which is the greatest document of all time, you think they were dealing with their lower self? No. They said, we hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal. And that all with certain inalienable rights such as life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. That sounds like constitutional talk to me. That's the remedy that we need. This is the way we're going to fix the problems and our solution to society. By agreeing on a set of standards, a set of rules that all will be governed by. Because that's economic security. It must be in connection with your religious aims and belief. So when we read our Circle 7 Quran, which is our religious aims and belief, we're learning our civic duty, our civic instructions. Because the First Amendment says Congress can make no law respecting or prohibiting the free practice thereof. The Congress cannot make no law. It says the enumeration in this Constitution cannot deprive those rights already retained by the people. This is a holy book, Moors. But man like to follow and not lead. He needs a pattern for his life. He needs a pattern. So what's the pattern? We can't look to another man for it. Because man don't even know himself. The prophet said in the scriptures that something is added unto thee unlike what thou knowest. He said something informs the clay, the physical, above all the objects of thy senses. Behold, what is it? See, we got to stop thinking with our five senses. Think, taste, touch, smell, and sight. This is what's getting us in the trouble that we're in today. Because they only attribute to the physical, the carnal self, the body of desires. And when the body of desires is in play, it don't care what it wants. So this is the reason why he said, let the hand of justice lead thee right. Because you're not thinking about it yourself, you're thinking about your brother man, your sister. Because you cannot enjoy any of this but within the bands of society. The prophet covers all that, Moors. But man likes to follow and not lead. He don't want instruction. He don't want to have a clear conception of what they called to do. Because that's responsibility. That's responsibility. Remember that the engine importance of thy trust is far more than the height and the dignity of thy station. So when we think we got this so-called knowledge, and we think about the station and the height and the dignity that we're sitting at, we become all boastful and proud. The prophet said that in chapter 31, what he speaks about with that. Chapter 40, I mean. He said, inconstancy is powerful in the heart of a man. He said, and temper sways it. It withers its will. He said, despair engrosses much of it. He said, fear proclaimeth. Behold, I should unravel therein. He said, but vanity is beyond them all. Let's go a little further. It says, weep not therefore at the calamities of the human state. Rather laugh at his follies. In the hands of the man addicted to vanity, life then but is the shadow of a dream. Let's go to verse 3. He says, the hero, the most renowned of human characters. What is he but a bubble in this weakness? The public is unstable and ungrateful. Why should a man of wisdom endanger himself for fools? The man who neglects his present concerns revolves how he would behave when greater feeds himself with winds, while his bread is eaten by another. This is our problem, mortals. We're trying to find a remedy in the so-called process that they gave us. But there is no remedy. Because our government must be expression of the will of the people. And who are the people? The people are classified as Negro, Black, Colored, and Ethiopian. Because they proclaim this. Proclaim means to declare according to a governmental procedure. And you need to declare it for yourself. They proclaimed it for you. But if you don't go fix that, then you get what you deserve. You get what you deserve. Look at the so-called treatments that we get as a people. They tax us to death. They throw us in prisons. We can hardly survive. Where's this justice in that? So we don't have our concerns in order. We're going to school to be doctors, to be lawyers, to be engineers, under the auspices of economic power. But what did Jesus say about power? Power is an illusion. It is a result of force, nothing more. He said power is that will and manifest, directed by holy breath. What is holy breath? Truth. But man is truth and false is strangely mixed. They're conjoined in him. Here's the reason why we must receive the instructions that Jesus and Mary and Elizabeth received. We need those teachings. The teachings need to be simplified. Because the word Elizabeth means house of flesh and Mary means womb. So Elihu means Lord and Hill means creative force of will. So they were being taught God's will in the womb to instruct them so when their physical matured and grew, they would know how to direct it. So it says, let the action, let the love of thy law direct the action. Listen, let the love of thy law direct thy flesh. Let the actions of thy life show the love of his law. This is what talked about in chapter 35. Your nature. What is your nature? Because nobody's already seen your nature. Is either of the higher self and the lower self? You got to choose. You have to choose. You are a citizen of the United States of America, the Republic. You are a member of the Moorish Scientific America, which is the name of your national, the Moorish Scientific America, which is the name of your national government. And if a man is born and raised and failed to give that free national name, his flag, and every other thing that's required to be part of a nation, then you are imprisoned, abused, mistreated, and anything that the citizens care to bestow upon you. Because you're forgetting your obligation as a citizen to maintain justice, which is your social duty in society. And the only way that can be done is by making sure that that justice is done in purity and love, which only comes through a moral standing, which only comes through the Creator. Because the Creator created you in His image. He said, when Allah speaks, He speaks through men so men can comprehend. But man has to be dealing with his higher soul. This is the reason why Nojali gave us our 101s, which is the language. So anytime you come with a problem in life, you can always reflect back to those 101s and get the answers that you need. Let the love of his law direct you. Let it direct you, but we don't want direction. As I come to the closing of my lesson, I'm going to read something from the Savior of Humanity, from the Prophet Moorish. And let's see the sincerity of the Prophet Noor Bedr Ali. And in this particular ayat, he speaks on how he didn't think about himself. He understand that the so-called leaders that we so-called had were inconstant. They were unstable because they had no love for the law. And Noor Bedr Ali lost all sight of that because he understand that everything hangs upon the law. Everything. But our law is specific. What law are we talking about? The laws of humanity. The prophet said, in this electrified age, men are racing into this life without complete knowledge of where they are going or what the end will be. When riches seems to be their only pursuit, to be attained at any rate and at any cost. When selfishness, avarice, and greed, lust, dominate their very being. When humanity in general is left at the mercy of those who have no mercy in them. It is truly wonderful and astounding to see one come into this mad human drama for the sole purpose of saving humanity. Losing all sight of those things worldly and yielding absolutely to a cause higher than has yet ever been obtained. This picture is the likeness of the Prophet Noor Bedr Ali, who is serving humanity, not taking advantage of it, who's serving humanity. Coming as he does with a message for the nations in the somewhat the same manner as did Jesus, Muhammad, Buddha, Confucius, and other prophets of their day. The teaching of this prophet days differ from the ills of the days of the past. And yet the remedy for the ills of today is about the same as the remedies for the days of the past. All turning about the pivot of love. Love for humanity. It says humanity must be lifted from the unwholesome depths of poverty, misery, and suffering, and placed on a solid rock of salvation. There are some who claim to do this, but upon investigation, one finds that they have slouched under the wings of their cross to extract from those who come to them means by which they can have the pleasures of this life while they point their followers to joy after death. While they feed their sheep, they also shear them while eating. At the close of the day, the master will be heard to tell them, you have your reward. Get thee hence. Where is it that you find a real prophet whose mission is the salvation of the nations? The land is full of false prophets whose mission is to fleece the people. The time was and now is that there should come into the land a prophet in the likeness of his brothers to redeem them from sin and slavery. Truly this prophet is Noor Bedr Ali. Truly this prophet is Noor Bedr Ali, is the man, bringing with him a message of love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice, which alone can save the nations. Like the coming of Jesus, he does not come from the elect, nor the rich, nor the mighty in the worldly power. But all power is given unto him to do good. This power is from Allah. It will be his works that will make men of every nation accept the truth that he brings. It will be through his teachings that the nations of earth will understand the will of the master. It will be through him that peace on earth and goodwill to all men shall come. It will be through his works that humanity will be brought from the slimes of life and placed on the solid rock of salvation. If you read the education of Mary Elizabeth, they say the same thing. In order for you to reveal the light, you must have the light. So this is what our job is. We have the light now, Moors. Our job is to spread the gospel, goodwill to all men, and peace on earth. And the only way we can express that is through enforcing justice, which is the Constitution, which protects all those who claim to be part of humanity. And with that, I say, Islam. Next demonstration will be that of part himself. Grand Sheik will come in and allocate the next speaker.
Islam, Moors.
Islam.
Islam. We're going to bring on the next speaker, Brother Terrence Bey. Come exercise the five senses according to law. Give him your same undivided attention. Islam.
Islam.
It's our rise and be praised by the Prophet Noor Bedr Ali. Everyone in attendance here. Islam.
Islam. Islam.
Brother Sheik plus touched on a lot of points. I'm going to reiterate. And Father Supka. In the statements, Prophet Noble Drew Ali, statement 74 states, if my principles are not carried out, the worst is yet to come. Statement 78 says, more study yourself. 208 says, the garment that I have on represents power. And if you obey my voice, you will have power with me. Now, page 3, Holy Quran, deals with a little portion. By these lessons, you can set your house in order. Hold that thought. In order to change the condition of the people, you must first change their literature. Hold that. But they must have the light before they can reveal the light. Hold that. Question 41. What is the everlasting gospel?
It's the saving power that come from Allah, my ancient fathers, by his prophet.
Question 15. For what purpose was the Moorish Science Temple founded?
For the upliftment of fallen humanity.
Okay. Point 1. Noble Drew Ali went to the U.S. government, reclaimed the Moorish nationality, and let them know that black, Negroes, colored Ethiopians were not the correct name describing olive brown indigenous people of North, South, Central America. These names was forced upon them during the European colonization of their land. Point 2. African Americans are only quasi-citizens, meaning as if, of Washington, D.C., and have civil rights, not human rights. So now, this is going to complement what I'm dealing with mental transportation. So we want to change the minds of the people. Or changing the literature. Right? We're not familiar with masculine and feminine principles. You know? Active, receptive. Right? I'm just going to pick in part of it and I'm elaborate as I go. Okay? The tendency to female principle is always in the direction of receiving impressions, while the tendency of the masculine principle is always in the direction in giving out or expressing. Feminine principle has a much more varied field of operation than it has the masculine principle. The feminine principle conducts the work of generating new thoughts, concepts, ideas, including the work of the imagination. The masculine principle contends itself with the work of the will in his varied phrases, and yet the active aid in the will of the masculine principle. The feminine principle is apt to rest content with generating mental images, which are the result of impressions received from the outside instead of producing original mental creations. Now, if we take that and bring it to what Drew Ali brought, let's let his masculine principle go into our minds. Follow? Persons who give continued attention and thought to a subject activity employ both of the mental principle, the feminine, and the work of the active mental generation. And the masculine will is stimulating and energizing the creative portion of the mind. So in order to change the condition of the people, you must change the literature. Right? So, in order to reveal the light, you must have the light, right?
So.
Okay. Let's go a little bit further, and I'm going to bring this all back full circle. These are examples I'm just going to hit. Telepathy, thought transference, mental influence, suggestion, hypnotism. In the phenomenon of telepathy, it is seen that the vibratory energy of the masculine principle, Drew Ali, is projected toward the feminine principle, the consciousness of the minds of the people, or another person, and later takes the seed thought and allows it to develop into maturity. So, We take all the information Drew brought and let it sit in our minds and let it cultivate and give it the attention we need. Mm-hmm. We will understand the works that it can produce, which is going to go into the excerpt I'm going to read later. The masculine principle of the person giving the suggestion directs, and the latter accepting it makes it its own, and acts and thinks accordingly. Now we take two ways. If we take Negro, Black, and Color type of psychologies and ideologies, we take that and let that sit. That's what we're going to basically act out. You all agree? So now we got to get into, what are we putting our attention to? Mm-hmm. What are we focusing on? Mm-hmm. Because if it's not that which I just read in this, in the literature, we can see how it's going to be opposite from it. So, changing the mental state or mental transmutation. I'm about to start calling on people now. This interaction is going to be beneficial. Sheik Cliff. What's one of the formulas into this change?
The three-step process, which we call in the more science of America, belief, faith, and fruition. Believeful man knows to be the truth. Believeful man believes perhaps it's the truth. Faith is what man knows to be the truth. And fruition is the man becoming that truth. So
basically, Drew came to change our vibratory rate. What's in my way? You agree with that? Sister Mom, how did he do that?
Changing our vibratory.
Yeah. That's a good example.
By raising, changing our literature, teaching us to be ourselves, to walk in the higher self and not the lower. So, change our thinking, change the way we think, see things.
So, the Asiatics in North America was falsely calling himself Negro, Black, and Colored people. So that'll go into being ordained by Allah, right?
Okay.
Brother Maury, why was it that we needed it the most? Why was it that the Asiatics in North America needed it the most?
Well, we'll go with Duali being the last prophet of his time to bring this nation of his people from the island and oppression of the things that were in our land at this time. And that's given us in his life, we're not given to us the most because we were the people that was misled upon ourselves, either Black or Colored, when every other person had nationality in our land.
We had a nationality, just wasn't conscious of it. So, speaking of nationality now, on page 3, it says, these are the Moabites, Hamathites, Canaanites, who were driven out of the land of Canaan by Joshua and received permission from the pharaohs of Egypt to settle in that portion of Egypt. So what does that mean? Sheik Emmanuel. In later years, they formed themselves kingdoms. These kingdoms were called this day, Morocco, Algiers, Tunis, Tripoli, etc., right? Okay. So here it is, continent. Let me go to it right now. Go to 47. Go to 6. The Moabites.
Chapter 47, verse 6.
The Moabites from the land of Moab who received permission from the pharaohs of Egypt to settle and inhabit Northwest Africa. Well, we've been found out now that Northwest Africa was North America. And They were the founders and all the true possessors of the present Moroccan Empire, with their Canaanite, Hittite, Amorite brethren, who sojourned from the land of Canaan, seeking new homes. Now, why is this important to uplift a person?
That's not. Papa said, you are with your forefathers, but without dying contradiction. Nobody has the power of disability from the distinct nature of your forefathers, unless his power be extended beyond the Creator himself. We know that's not the case. And Jadi said, the Moroccans are the true possessors. So we're the citizens of the ancient Moroccan, not the one you see there now. You know what I'm saying? And remember, the government must be expression of the will of the people, by virtue of the fact that we are the people who are the citizens of the people who control this land, and this land belongs to us. But we must do that by name and principle. It's not.
So, Moabites, Moroccans, Moorish. Moroccans short for Moabites, Moorish short for Moroccans. Right? Good?
So.
All right. Now, this is going to complement what you just done over. To change your mood or mental state, change your vibration. Change your mood or mental state. What was the mood of our people prior to consciousness? Mm-hmm. Brother, are you want to do that? Sister Marie.
Submissive. Mm-hmm. Okay. If we could sum it up with one word. My
subjective, submissive,
bigger people.
Okay. So if this is the mental state, what's going to follow? These actions is going to be degenerate actions, right? Mm-hmm. And that's going to go into a generation of this breed or psychology. Mm-hmm. Okay. So. One may change his mental vibration by effort of will. What was Jirali's will for his people?
Islam.
This is a broad question. What we want to answer? Throw it out there.
Prophet said, tune thy will and allow the defied will, so the resurrection could be a fact.
Okay. So what was one of the first things he informed the people when he talked the message? General question.
First things
he Sheik Emmanuel. Okay. What else he informed the people? Oh, he dealt with the people. Higher self and lower self. So he mixed up metaphysics, if you want to call it that, with history. Okay. So we understand change the mood, change the mental state, change the vibration. So how can you change your vibration? By an effort of will. In the direction of deliberately fixing the attention upon a more desirable state. So what is the more desirable state as far as more science is concerned? Higher self. So you know the two poles of higher self and lower self. Fix your will towards more to the higher self. So you won't be affected by the lower self. That makes sense?
Islam.
Right. So Sister Monica, repeat that for me. You understand that?
Yeah. You're saying to stay in tune with your higher self, so lower self can be affected. The character you are,
So the consciousness. Well, the more science temple would be the higher self.
Right.
In this literature, which will change your mind. That's his general, not direct to his. Right. So we all follow, right?
So.
You want to take it to where you took it at, but don't reiterate this. All right. So it is not strange. So no happenings. Law govern all events. Right? So we're going back to, Jolie coming. Ordained, right? And 26 says, and when the world is ready to receive, lo, Allah will send a messenger to open the books and copy from his sacred pages all the messages of purity and love. So what's the saving power again?
Saving power.
Yeah, so what did Jew bring? Didn't he bring this? Mm-hmm. All right, so that'll be the saving power. Mm-hmm. Okay, and with these lessons, you can do what with them? Now we talk mentally. Get the mental state in order. Right? Mm-hmm. So, 18, chapter 2. To teach them that Allah and man are one, but that through cardinal thoughts and words and deeds, man tore himself away from Allah, debased himself. So why is mental transportation and changing your mental state so important? Because you want to... Oh, brother?
Yes, sir. Arise and give praise to Allah. High honors to Nobuchadur Ali. Honors to my grand sheikh. Honors to everyone here. Islam.
Islam.
Yet the higher self and the lower self, and they're pulled up one another. Like, for example, money, one puller will be rich, one will be poor. If you keep going around, well, I ain't got no money, I got to pay these bills, but you're gravitating yourself more towards the poor puller. Just like with the high self and the lower self, you can raise your ether by manifesting love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice, higher mm-hmm. self activities, and you raise your etherical rate.
I left something out in that scripture I read. It says, in the flesh of man, there is resurrection of the dead. And when quickened by holy breath, we raise the essence of the body to a higher tone. Because man is not the body nor the soul, he's the spirit. So.
Right. So, the consciousness that Jew Ali brought back for our uplifting, we was considered what?
Negro, black, color,
fallen humanity.
Fallen humanity, so.
Right? So that's the importance we're dealing with, right?
I know we didn't question anything.
Let's see if any different now. It says that who is Allah, right? What's the answer to that?
Allah is the father of the universe.
Okay. 7, it says, what is the duty of a prophet?
Save the nations from the wrath of Allah.
Okay. So how did Jew Ali save the nations?
By teaching them to be themselves.
The Negro, black, and colored, according to the record, as Sheik says, is what?
Name given us by the European in 1779. That's what, 1865 from the time of slavery.
Mm-hmm. But according to all true and divine records,
there is no Negro, black, colored in local kind of monkey in the family. All mm-hmm. members of the family are children of the great God of Allah.
Right. So, chapter 47, it says, right? Through sin and disobedience, every nation has suffered slavery due to the fact that they honor not the creed, the principles of their forefathers. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, what's the saving power?
It's everlasting gospel.
From who?
By cover of Allah. From cover of Allah by prophets.
All right. So, we violated and fell because we did not honor that, right? So Jew Ali brings us back and informs us how we fell once before with the intentions of bringing us back, right? So that's leading to 17. That's why the nationality of the Moors was taken away from them in 1774. The word Negro, black, and color was given to the Asiatics of America who were of Moorish descent because they honored what not? The mother and father. And straight after God's rebuke,
they knew
nothing. So, why is it that when we step to our brothers and sisters now, it's hard? How are we going to shine light on them if we don't got the light? Talkers of being of the villas of light. It's not on folks and on the media to hear, it's just in general, just disseminating information. So the question I asked right now was that how can you put mental transmutation with the Holy Quran? How can you change the mental state of people with that? How can you use that for a formula?
The prophet said, you read from the record.
Mm-hmm.
Chapter 14. Part of chapter 4. Mm-hmm. Prophet said in chapter 4, verse 14, he said, man needs a pattern for their lives. They love to follow and not lead. Since the man who stands upon the corner of the path and points the way but does not go is disappointed, and a block of wood can do the same. Verse 16, the teacher treads his way on every span of ground and leaves his footprints clearly cut, which all can see and be assured that he, the master, went that way. Verse 17, men comprehend the inner life by what they see and do. They come to alive through ceremonies and form. So when you make men know that sin are washed away by purity in life, a right symbolic is being introduced. And that's what that's saying. In other words, Ali introduced a rite of symbolic of purity in his demonstration. So many people get caught up in what Noble Jai look like, and they don't get caught up in what makes him look like he do. Because we judge people not what they seem, but what they are. So the very identity or perception that we see from Noble Jai is not based off the outer look, but the internal look. And that's Islam.
Islam. Sheikh Shanti.
What I get from the passage is you become the circle of seven. That's how you get people to adhere to what you're saying about the circle of seven. You actually become the circle of seven.
Say the fruition.
Mm-hmm. And that goes back to being the before you can reveal it, you
must have it.
Have it before you can give it to others.
Mm-hmm. In order to have it, what must you be then? Mm-hmm. What was wrong? So the light gotta get, gotta come to you, right?
Yeah.
Right. Seek him anywhere? I got you, man.
Just like Sheik said that the Holy Quran, it has to become the language. It has to be, you know, the way you speak has to be based on that.
Mm-hmm.
It's your master lesson. You know how to talk like that.
That's right.
Brother Old.
It's something I like what Emmanuel just said, first of all. You got to speak your language all the time. You got to speak love, truth, peace, spirit, and justice. Just not turn it off and on. You never know who's watching, right?
Mm-hmm.
What I wanted to build on, when you teaching somebody, you're giving them his life, you got to see where they're at first. You know, you bring them up from there, you got to make sure they understand what you're saying. You know, and ask them how to demonstrate that. You know, and they demonstrate, oh yeah, I see how you bring them up to another level. And you keep teaching them, you know. Do they say, Mom, I'm ready to go with you to the temple.
Mm-hmm. It's not. And a good example is that when the star speaks, he speaks to men. So what we don't understand that the main key is enforcing justice. And that only comes to your religious aims and belief, which is your moral standing. And how you can prove that, if you go to Act 4 of our Divine Constitution bylaws, it says, all men must obey these holy divine laws, and all men must obey the laws of the government. By being the most American, you are part and parcel of the government, must live your life accordingly. Act 5 says this organization of the Moorish Scientific America is not to cause any confusion, or to overthrow the laws and constitution of the said government, but to obey them hereby. So that's telling you right there that your obligation to your social duty is to be who you say you are by words, deeds, and actions.
So this compliment social duty excerpt from the Moorish God, Friday, September 14th, 1928. Page 12. The Moorish Science Temple of America. The Moorish Science Temple of America was founded by Prophet Noble Drew Ali. Aside from the fact that it is a legally organized religious corporation, it is building on human needs. So again, Jew came to uplift all humanity. The desirable end, in time, legitimate means, will be bound to disperse charity, provide for the mutual assistance of his members in times of distress, to aid in improvement of health, to encourage the ownership of better homes, to find employment for our members, to teach those fundamental principles which are desired for our civilization, such as obedience to law, loyalty to government, tolerance, and unity. So, that's part of the light. from a humanitarian perspective. Mm-hmm. Now let's go further down the page. We are the Moorish Science Temple of America, like countless other American citizens, know that we must live together here in America in harmony, friendship, and goodwill, whatever our race or creed may be. Hold that. Well, I'm gonna take it from this. Any questions? As of right now, until I find this part? Okay. Holding instructions on unity. Now, this is what the prophet is conveying. He gives some understanding on treasures of the law. And he appointed to every one his portion and what measure seemeth good unto himself. So this is part of the higher self-information. Has he endowed thee with wisdom? Has he enlightened thy mind with knowledge of truth, communicated to the ignorant for their instruction, communicated to the wise for thy own improvement? True wisdom is less pursuing than folly. The wise man doubteth often and changes his mind. The fool is obstinate and doubteth not. He knoweth all things but his own ignorance. The pride of emptiness is an abomination. To talk much is the foolishness of folly. Nevertheless, it is part of wisdom to hear with patience their impertinence and to pity their absurdity. Yet be not puffed up in thy own conceit, neither boast of superior understanding. The clearest human knowledge is but blindness and folly. The wise man filleth his imperfections and is humble. He laboreth in vain for his own approbation. But the fool peepeth in the shallow stream of his own mind, and is pleased with the pebbles which he seeth at the bottom. He bringeth them up and showeth them as pearls, and with the applause of his brethren delighteth himself. This is one of my favorite verses right here. He boasts of attainments and things that are of no worth, but where it is a shame to be ignorant, he has no understanding. Now let's go back to Negro, Black, and Colored condition. I see a lot of people, the son of my own kind, they boast about attainments that has no worth. Mm. And where's the shame to be ignorant, they have no understanding.
So,
just like yesterday, we took a little outing, and there's a certain group of Asiatics just playing into Negro, Black, and Colorism. They didn't know it, though. You know, I knew it. I heard how they was talking and everything. And it's like they're boasting of attainments. I mean, things that just have no relevance to none of their condition. No, I didn't say, "Ho, brother, you're out of order. Let me hit you with this." No. It's more of a yearning that our people get together and really consider what's being said. You know? So, eight. Even in the path of wisdom, he toileth after folly, and shame and disappointment are the reward of his labor. Sheik Nature, can you elaborate on that? Touch upon that? Even in the path of wisdom, he toileth after folly, and shame and disappointment are the reward of his labor.
So, even in the path of wisdom, after the following. I see that to mean sometimes we get into that state of mind as the pretender wise, and we claim to have a higher understanding because we might be exposed to certain information or be exposed to certain circles that represent a higher realm of consciousness. And because we associate ourselves with that, we take the position that we're one with that vibration. But we make claims to that vibration or that school of thought, but then we still participate in behavior that represents another or a lower vibration. Mm-hmm. So
So even in the path of wisdom, as we're part of this school or realm where we're supposed to be changing our behavior for the better, we're in that realm but still participating in behavior that's at a lower realm when we know we have no intentions on to change that and do greater things. So when we do that, when we claim a higher understanding or be associated with a higher realm of consciousness, and we still participate in a lower realm, the fact that we know truth from falsehood and we still choose the falsehood, we get our reward for that. So no justice. Karmatic laws come into play in that type of situation because we know better. As soon as you know something to be a fact and you go against that, your reward becomes that much greater.
I'm going to come back off that, going back to my lesson, speaking about inconstancy. You know, when you deal with inconstancy, once again, you're not obliged to doing what you're supposed to do. So, and I lost my train of thought real quick, so I'm going to come back to that.
All right, going back to the masculine and feminine principle. Now, this is, you'll see how this is applicable. The masculine principle in the average person is too lazy to act. The display of willpower is too slight, and the consequence is that such persons are ruled almost entirely by the minds and wills of other persons. So if you want to be dominated by another person's will, I suggest you get the literature of No Drudgery, whom they follow to do their thinking and willing for them. Powerful original thoughts or original actions are performed by the average person. Or not the majority of the people mere shadows and echoes of others having stronger wills or minds than themselves. So again, we all hear the Sheik talk about who's establishing the jurisdiction for different people. And you can put that with that. Just like with anything. Is that? The trouble is that the average person dwells amongst all together in his me. Well, then go over that. Now I want to get people off. Basically, people who have a stronger masculine principle can dominate those with the weaker one, and they become totally on a feminine receptive. And going back when I first opened up about planting the seeds. So, the seeds that I want to plant today is the consideration of getting in tune with this type of science. So you can vibrate at a higher level and you can start demonstrating differently. Because when you get into the minimalism of things, you understand what you was talking about. Study yourself. Right. I will conclude our demonstration on mental transportation, compliments of Holy Quran, and more science to come. God, I say peace.
Peace.
Islam.
Islam.
Everybody all right?
Islam.
Islam. Next speaker we're going to bring forth is Sheik Shatik. He comes to exercise his five senses.
Islam.
Islam, Moors.
Islam.
I've already given my praises and honors, so I'm not going to start that. I'm going to get back to our conduct and our character. That was my lesson last week, but this time I'm going to get more like in depth. I don't like what I see when I see the members come in to the temple. I love all of you, and I'm sure you know that. I'm talking about your dress code. We never come into the temple just dressed any kind of way, like dungarees, sweatshirts, and stuff like that. This is not the place for that. This is a place of higher vibrations, higher tones, and higher self and character. If you don't have it, then I can understand. Standard. If you don't have it, then you need to let me know, because I have a lot of stuff I don't have need of. I could part with it. if you're that size, or like if not, I can make arrangements. But I'm quite sure some of us here have dress shirt, dress pants, and stuff like that. This is how we should come in to the temple and represent, because this is what we stand for, a higher vibration, and what we're being perceived as from the outside is what people see. They only go by what they see. Again, I'm not getting on your case, Moors. I'm just stating a fact that we're supposed to come and represent our house looking properly regaled. If you were like in a lodge or like any other place or temple, unless if you didn't have it, they would help you and provide you with it. If you do have it, I suggest that you come dress properly next time, Moors. Because it's long. Yes, yes. Thank you, Brother Emmanuel. This, we are, as I speak, with the government, all of us. We represent a form of government, so we should act according and look according. Like I said, I'm not here to get on your case, but I am stressing character and conduct, and that's a part of our character, that's a part of our conduct. Since I've been in the Moorish Science Temple, you always come properly regaled. You just don't come in your street corner wear. I am disappointed with that. So I wanted to express that in my lesson with the character and conduct. Because what the people see us look like when we come into our house is what they're going to perceive. Oh, well, it doesn't matter how you come in there. Look at the prophet. Do you see him wearing Timberland boots and so forth? No. The prophet and all that comes in the temple around the prophet is properly regaled. So more, less find it in our hearts so that we can make that happen. If you need help, let me know. I got plenty of stuff. Islam.
Islam, just to camel back on what you were saying, that's with any place of inquiry. When you work at a job, like I work in the CS department, if I walk in there with some regular street clothes on, I can cross-contaminate. I have to wear scrubs. Because within the scrub, there's a language that people can identify with. So when nobody fits with this language and the clothing that dress our attire, people know about who we are by based off how we look. We tell people not what they see, but what they are. So they quick to 7:30 us. So if you're dressed in the tie, they won't be quick to 7:30 you or racial profile you because you have the character. So.
And I'm saying, yeah, I'm saying that too. But I'm saying in essence, if we were to draw any type of people towards us or towards the temple, we have to look and conduct and carry ourselves a certain kind of way. That's the whole time I was sitting there pondering my thoughts on what I was going to say. This is what I have to say to you brothers and sisters. Mainly, you brothers. I'm going to keep it straight 100. Mainly, you brothers. I've been coming for a while, and I've been seeing quite a few of you come. I've never said nothing about it. But now, being that we're on the subject of social duties, on the subject of inconstancy, on the subject of instabilities, on the subject of weakness, on the subject of misery, on the subject of Elihu's teaching Mary and Joseph so that they could teach their sons, we have to learn from all of them lessons and look the part. Come and make our house look good. We represent this. This helps us. We help it. We represent what the prophet stands for. So these are the things he stands for. Looking good and standing of good character and being seen as such. You know what I'm saying? Not saying that you're not, because I'm not saying that. Yeah, you have the Fezzle and you got part of it. But the rest of it don't fit. It doesn't show righteousness. I know that you are, but the people, they see you, they don't know it. So we have to represent that, Morris, so that we don't be misunderstood or misplaced. We've already had this, civics part of it. This is this part of it. With that, I'm not going to hold a class any longer. I have that to say. I have that to get off of my heart. Peace.
Peace and love.
Islam, Morris.
Islam.
All right, Islam, I'm going to continue the meeting. And I'm kind of, even though we were dealing with politics the whole time, because politics means the science of government. That's what the word politics means. So just clearing up concepts I like to teach and give us something that we can utilize and help others with. So when we speak to our brothers in the street and they hear you talk a nationality or something, and they say, oh, you dealing with that politics, we don't get into that. Just let them know the word politics just means the science of government. Government means the people collectively. So politics just means the science of people. So if you don't deal with politics, then you're not dealing with people. You're not dealing with yourself, because you're a part of the word people. People is plural for the word person, natural persons, that is. You understand? So we got to deal with language, terminology, and that's how, once again, how you clear up concepts. This is how you improve your society by just, you know, each one teach one. That's a collective concept that we have to carry on. Islam?
Islam.
So Islam, I want to give honor to everyone who actually brought some information to us, because that's what it's all about. Islam, everybody has their portion. So here's what I'm going to break down today. Something that's an ongoing and an uphill battle. The concept of the word proclamation. Proclamation. The etymology of the word means to, well, means proclaim. Pro means for, and claim. You know what the word claim means? Play your main well. All right. What's wrong?
Salvage.
All right. Islam, brother, sister, man.
To state something.
All right. All that, all of the above is actual correct. Brother Emmanuel, can you give us a definition of the word claim according to a dictionary? Islam. Islam. While he's doing that, I'm going to go forward in a couple of things here. I have an example template, an actual proclamation document that we issue here in the Moorish Science Temple of America, Temple Number 10. Right. In lieu of Article or Act 6 of the Divine Constitution and bylaws of the Moorish Science Temple, it states to us that with us, all must proclaim their nationality, right?
Islam.
All who? All members. This is key. Members. Member is a citizen. Citizen is a member. Remember, think, this is a government. It is a government. Not think it's a government, but know it's a government. Right, so we're using the term member and citizen interchangeably anytime we use that. But with us, all members must proclaim their nationality. And we are teaching our nationality, right?
Islam.
So that's part of why we're here. This is what these public meetings are for. Notice I said public meetings. Because we have other meetings outside of public meetings. Certain meetings are private. So with that being said, we want to clarify what proclaiming your nationality actually means. Nationality breaks down to the word nation. So what you're saying interchangeably is proclaiming your nationality means you're proclaiming a nation. This is just basic 101, but you got to understand it this way. Proclaiming a nation, i.e. means to proclaim a government, or what they refer to as a nation state. Because a nation is a government. So that eliminates the idea, concept of someone saying that Moorish American, because that's your free national name, right? National, once again, means nation. That means that's your nation's name. So breaking it down, that's your government's name. Very simple. So Moorish American is not just what is referred to as your national name or your free national name, but it's your government's name. Also, your free government's name. Everybody clear on that understanding? So the Prophet Noble Jor Ali instructed the Asiatics of North America that they must proclaim their free national name and religion. For what purpose? According to the lesson, to be recognized by who? By the government in which you live. And the nations of the earth. Islam. That's the main reason and objective that Allah, the great God of the universe, ordained Noble Jor Ali. That's the main reason. Alright? So that eliminates the idea of people saying, oh, that's a religious institution. Or Jor Ali just came as a religious figure, a religious leader. Erase that concept when you break down exactly what we just went over. He was ordained by Allah. Ordained by Allah to instruct you and to guide you into proclaiming your free government's name and being part and parcel with that. This is very important. We understand it this way. Sheik Emmanuel, you ready? All right, so to proclaim means to claim, because proclaim is basically for claim. So the root word and the key word is claim. Ready, man?
Claim, to call for, to ask, or seek to obtain by virtue of authority, right, or supposed right. To challenge as a right, to demand as due, as to claim the debt, to claim the being or respect.
If it's applicable. Yes, go ahead.
A demand of a right or supposed right. A calling on another for something due or supposed to be due. As a claim of wages for service. A claim implies a right or supposed right in the claimant to something which is in another possession or power. A claim may be made in words, by suit, and by other means.
A claim, repeat that because this is very important. A claim
may be made in words,
by suit,
and by other means.
Or by other means.
The word is usually preceded by make or lay, to make claim, to lay claim.
To make claim or to lay claim. Islam. All right, very important. Moving forward. Islam.
Claim and suit.
A claim could be made by way of a suit.
Okay.
All right. And I'm glad you asked that question, because we want everything to be clear. Don't be afraid if you don't understand something, ask. Because remember, we're teaching our people their nationality in this process. Islam, question or statement?
Statement.
Islam, go ahead.
Before she asked, I was saying, we're thinking that when you make a claim,
mm-hmm.
you're saying that some rights were violated.
That could, yeah, that could be. Remember, a claim involves a right.
Mm-hmm.
So whenever you're dealing with a claim or a proclaim, you're making reference to some type of right
mm-hmm.
that exists. Beacon call, prophet put out, come all ye Asiatics and hear the truth about your nationality and your birthrights. Know that you are not Negroes, colored folks, black people, or Ethiopians. Why? Because these names were given to slaves by slaveholders. Right? The fact that these names were given to slaves by slaveholders, that process was a claim in itself.
Right.
They your European nations proclaimed, or also termed declared, that a certain group of people were actually slaves. They claimed it. And they claimed that they had a right to their property, and that so-called Negroes were their property. So by them proclaiming that these people were Negro, blacks, and colored, and that they were their property, that they were slaves, they were making a claim to what they called their right, that they had a right to their property, that no one can interfere with the relationship between them and their slaves, because their slaves were their property and they had a right to them. So they put a claim in the system towards the people, towards the government. They put a claim to the people. They put a claim to the government. And they got the people to eventually accept this claim, where the people start to convince themselves and to agree to themselves that they were Negroes, black people, colored, or Ethiopian, and that they were slaves. At one time, they agreed that that they were a slave. They used that terminology as well. So therefore, what they did was they validated the claim instead of what is called challenging the claim. Once a claim has been entered into the record, this could be court or the public record at large, once a claim is instituted, if it's not challenged in law, this is called is waived. Once it's waived, also called acquiescence, it stands as law until it's challenged, regardless if it's true or not. The fact that it's been claimed and no one challenged it means that it's law, and the person who claimed it is entitled to that, regardless if it's true, bogus, or what. The fact that if a bogus claim has not been challenged, that bogus claim becomes law until that bogus claim becomes challenged. That's law. We need to understand that. And the Constitution protects and secures that claim unless it's challenged. So therefore, the fact that this occurred in 1779, that this claim was entered into the record in 1779, the Asiatics of North America was under this particular claim until 1865, according to a certain portion of law. We're going to get into that as well. Until 1865. That claim was lingering in this system of law here in America, in this portion of the United States of America. It was made law until something was challenged in 1865 that kind of put a monkey wrench in that particular system of law.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you go back and reread your Constitution, 1865 was the period or the time or the year that was supposed to end slavery. And then the prophet says, because or being that, this is a new era of time now. And now all men must proclaim their free national name to be recognized by the government in which they live in the nations of the earth. The reason why he made this statement is because he's going with the sequence of law. He's going according to law. And according to the system that they had in place, 1865, they were supposed to end slavery because that claim of slavery was challenged in 1865 by Abraham Lincoln. We need to understand what Acts 6 is talking about. We need to understand what the whole Moorish doctrine is talking about. But that's the root and the heart of the movement. We need to understand that for starters. But I'm going to go further into it. Brother Omari had his hand.
Oh, yeah. I just want to say something popped in my head when he was talking about making public proclamations.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Is that more or less the reason why not necessarily Moors, but other citizens put their names in the papers when they make a name change of direction to basically generally make a wave in the town?
Yes. Two things to that. When you're doing a name change, everyone has a right to their name. And they also have a right to their nationality. Right? Two different parts, and that's good because we're going to get into that as well. But just for the surface of what you're talking about, when someone makes a claim in a paper to a name, that's part of the process and protocol for a name change. So when one wants to institute just a general name change, even though they might not be dealing with nationality, just to do a name change, part of the process of that is that you have to notify the public. You have to make this claim to the public. And you have to give the public a chance to counterclaim your claim. So according to common law, the process of a name change is you want to make a claim, you got to give the people a fair chance to counterclaim that based on any debts, contracts that you might have, outstanding balances you might have under the previous name. So they want to make sure you're not trying to get out of an obligation that you have made in one name, and you're saying your intent to change the name is not based on you trying to get out of debt. They want to make sure the change of name is based on good intent, spiritual, religious reasons, etc. Some might change their name based on marriage. Whatever the situation is, all of that particular claim, reason, and intent, purpose has to be listed in writing in an affidavit form and entered into the public record to give the people a fair chance to challenge it just in case you were doing it for an immoral reason. That's dealing with name. But now that also deals with nationality. And we're not there yet, but that satisfies the name situation. That's why it's public in the newspaper, because the newspaper is the most common and the most effective way to produce a claim and the most effective way to challenge a claim. So the newspaper was, according to the common man, according to the sovereign, that was the means of conveyance or communication with the public, the newspaper. That's how it was anciently done. And it's still effective to this day. That's still a great means of notifying or producing a claim. The only problem with that nowadays is it's been bureaucratized, where there's only certain newspapers that they accept as what they call a public record. And those newspapers are now in a collusion or monopoly with the state corporation. So the state now controls the newspapers that they say that is a public record. So if we as a sovereign or Moorish American or a free national would like to go produce a claim in the paper now scrutinizes it and is up to their discretion if they want to publish it or not. And if it's inconsistent with the state's with the corporate state's agenda, they're going to tell you we can't do it. And that's what blocks the sovereign from his communication with the public. And that's part of our problem today, and that's something else that we're going to cover.
Islam, real brief, you spoke about claim, and claim being that you have the right to do so. And like you said, the European had put claims out as well. And one little claim is that deemed that we were slaves, because the 14th Amendment says, I mean, the 13th Amendment says no slavery should exist, voluntary or involuntary, in the United States except for crimes committed in the United States. Mm-hmm. And nationality is a crime. So the very fact you don't have a nationality, then you committed the crime right there. This is the reason why they're able to do the things they did.
Not proclaiming a nationality.
This is reason why.
Islam. Yeah, that's an international crime.
Islam.
So moving forward. So I'm just trying to speed up this concept here that we're trying to go over, what proclaim actually means. So now, when you speak about proclaim, although it's said to you can proclaim by making a speech or saying it, but there's proclaiming of different scenarios. You can proclaim different things. When you proclaim a name or a nationality, then there's a process that goes along with that. And that process has to be in harmony or in accordance with a governmental procedure. That's the difference between proclaiming the name of nationality and just proclaiming it with an unofficial use to it. Like, I can get up and I can make a statement and just say I'm God, which I am, but I'm just making a verbal claim. I can stand up and say, well, I own Asbury Park. I'm verbally making a claim. But that claim has no official or legal weight to it if it's not backed by documentation, affidavits, etc. That means whoever is or owns Asbury Park, their claim is in the record already. And by me just verbally saying I own it doesn't mean that I really own it. I have to go through a procedure to challenge the ownership thereof if I want the people to recognize me as being the owner. And that's the same thing that the prophet is saying when he says you must proclaim your free national name within the government in which you live, in the nations of the earth. What he's saying legally is you must proclaim or declare or put this claim of name and nationality in the public record. And allow that to be challenged. That's the foe for us, because we're allowing someone to challenge that, but it's a challenge for us too to be who we say we are. That's the challenge for us. Now, remember, the best challenge of all times is what the prophet did, because he was challenged. He didn't individually challenge the government for himself. He challenged the government for a whole so-called race of people, because they say black is a race. It's not a race. But to them, being that they refer to black as a race, he challenged a whole race according to their language. He went and made a claim in the public record and says, these people that you're referring to as Negro, blacks, and coloreds are not your property. They're not slaves, and that's not their name. And what he did was he claimed all of us for the public record. Some refer to that process as the adoption process, which is a whole nother lesson within itself. But it's true. The prophet claimed the whole Asiatic race of North America. He put challenges in the record that people who claimed to be the representatives of this nation at that time could not challenge him back. They tried to, but they could not produce a legitimate or superior claim to what the prophet's claim was about a whole so-called race of people. That's very, very deep. And I know that goes over some of our heads still to this day, because a lot of people out there still don't understand that. So they look at the prophet with less appreciation because of that. Because they don't really understand what he did. Some look at him as, like I said, a religious figure. Or he brought a religion. Or he was some type of representative of Islam. Or he was some type of American imam. you know, people look at them from all different levels. It's all based on their understanding. But even the representatives of the government at that time looked at him as a head of state. They didn't look at him as some religious guy or some grand sheik guy in the temple. That's not how they looked at him. They looked at him as a head of state. And even in lieu of that, because of that, and the respect they had for him, he was invited to Havana, Cuba, to speak at the League of Nations as a head of nation. So we got to check our records. We got to do our homework, find out what this is really all about. And also, when we proclaim our nationality, we need to understand what that's really about, so that we don't go back to today's lesson, we don't, in the path of wisdom, we don't be toiling after folly. Because now it becomes a legal obligation for us to proclaim our name and nationality and do something to the contrary thereof.
Teach me.
Because now what we're doing is taking a vow to defend and support the Constitution of the United States of America, and also to protect and defend the Constitution, the Divine Constitution, and the bylaws of the Moorish Science Temple of America. So that's a heavy obligation. And because we don't understand it, what happens is most of us fall short of what it represents, because it was never instructed properly when we did it. And we never really understood the legal ramifications behind what we did. So therefore, we fall short of its integrity, because we never really understood it. And this is what the prophet meant when he said, it's going to take you 50 years or better just to understand what I brought you. That's real. That's long.
Just to kick from the back of what you were saying, the prophet said in the Divine Word for the Nation, he said, through your free national name, you are known and recognized by the governments of the world according to the said government in which you live in. So if you got that name has to be recognized to be cognizant of. And they no matter what he did this for us. But it's based off our national standard that we're here before we even got on the plane to paint the manifesto. So this is the path, this is the pattern that our forefathers have left before, but we have to honor them through name and principle.
Islam. In support of that, back to your questionnaire. Have you ever really looked at this question? Did the angel give to the child that was called Jesus a holy name?
Yes. It cannot be used by those who are slaves to sin.
So, knowledge that degree. The answer is yes, the angel did give to the child that was called Jesus a holy name. Remember, he was called Jesus, but that wasn't his name. That's a degree. And not only did the angel give to the child that was called Jesus a holy name, because you know holy represents something divine, right? Pertaining to God. You know, and man and God is one. We understand that, right? We know we debased ourselves from God through carnal thoughts and deeds. So, the answer is yes, he did give him the name, but the name cannot be used by what? By those who are slaves to sin. So, it's multiple lessons within that. For starters, it cannot be used by those, meaning that the whole tent of the name Jesus was not meant for one individual. Do you hear that within the lesson? For those, meaning that the name Jesus was given to multiple people. You gotta understand that. But it cannot be given to those who are slaves to sin. So the other key word within that is slave. Because the term Jesus means justice, right? The term or the vibration of Jesus or justice is not in harmony with the word or the vibration of slave. So slave and justice is two different individuals, two different personalities, two different characters, two different vibrations, and in modern day term, two different statuses. Now we understand where that's going? So when we proclaim our, like the prophet said, our free national name, What we're saying is this status and this name and this vibration we're taking on is that of a free status. So when we make a claim to be free, then that means that our vibration, our reality, our psyche has to be that of being a free man or free woman. And we collectively have to represent that of a free nation. So we're taking an obligation and a vow to be free, and what we're saying is that we're not slaves to sin.
Islam.
We're saying that we're not slave to our lower self, and that's what the spiritual lessons is based on, where like the Quran teachings on, the Quran class that Cliff gave earlier. That's what you need to know so that you don't be a slave to sin. But also you can be a slave to another individual. You can be a slave to a corporation. You can be a slave to a slaveholder. You can be in debt to a bank. You can be in debt to multiple different things, which will compromise your freedom, your sovereignty. This compromises it when you get into debts and contracts with certain agencies, not knowing the terms and conditions of it, where you don't have no power and control over that particular contract. That's what makes you enslaved, and that's what the 14th Amendment is making reference to. Because you become subject to the jurisdiction thereof. Of who? Of whoever's claiming you. So what we need to understand is through birth certificate and certain contracts that our parents engaged us in, made us liable or contractable liable to certain debts and contracts that the U.S. corporation, because they're the ones who was making claims through their a third party of the international bankers, mainly of England, that they had an agreement with. So through third party, they signed our energies over to them. So this is an understanding we have to come to. So they made a claim to us, not as a people, a claim was put in 1779, but as an individual self. Once the birth certificate was executed, then that claim was assumed until we became 18 years of age. And once we became 18 years of age and we agreed knowingly, willingly, and intentionally, what we did was we made it a binding contract. Where we became personable liable, or i.e. slaves. Until we challenged that. And that's what the prophet is telling us that we must do by proclaiming your free national name and religion according to the governmental procedure that was laid down before you. He says that if you doubt my redemption process, listen to his words, if you doubt my redemption process is right for my people, then what do you need to do? Do you need to go to the church? Do you need to go to the priesthood, to the bishop?
Peace, Mo.
Did he say that?
No.
Where did he say go?
Go to those who know law.
Go to those in no law.
An intelligent tone.
No. Where?
In your city hall.
Go down to city hall if you got a problem with this or you don't understand something. Right? And what he say? Ask them under the intelligent tone. He means he's also telling you to state your claim there. You got to hear the prophet from a lawful perspective. Outside of the parables and codes he gave you in the Quran, you got to hear what he's really saying to you. And in order to do that, you got to know the language of the law to understand the language of the prophet. Brother Emmanuel.
You were talking about being slave to sin and the holy names, and I see how you correlated that with the El and Bey, which are the holy names.
Mm-hmm.
How, some people talking about the character and everything that goes along with you making a claim, you have to really be that mystery claim.
Indeed. You are your claim. So you want to claim a right. Remember, we're claiming our birthrights at this point. This is what we're making an attempt and we're striving to do. We first hear the truth about our birthright. Once you hear the truth about it and you agree with it, your next point of reference is to declare and proclaim that right, your birthright. Before I go further, Brother Terrence.
So you're saying sin is ignorance?
Sin is ignorance. And through sin and disobedience, every nation has suffered slavery. Due to the fact that they have not honored their mothers and their forefathers. That's our problem. So we were slaves to sin, just through the fact of being ignorant, through the fact that our parents was ignorant, right? And we participated in sinful acts. And we participated in what the prophet referred to as the great sin. Which must be removed. You understand, the great sin is the fact that you have not honored your mothers and fathers by what? By name and principles. So the name has everything to do with it. This is why the name is the first action at law. You know, when you change or correct your name, we use the term correct our name, right? But when you correct your name, that's considered a civil action. Why? Because civil pertains to citizenship. Not dealing with civil rights.
Please, man.
Just dealing with what the true term of the word civil means. All right? It's a civil action because it's an action that you must take to claim a right of name. It's an execution of an action. Back to what Monica asked earlier. Is in the form of a suit. You have to sue for a claim of right. That's what you're actually doing. Now somebody might challenge me and say, oh, where did it say that in the lesson? Where did the prophet say that at? He didn't say it in that form, but once you understand law and what proclaim means, and we just broke it down, we defined it, we looked it up into what they said claim means, and this is how you claim a right. This is how you challenge a right, is in the form of a suit. In order to claim a right to your property, to your name, to your nationality, or whatever you your right you say your right is, if it's to due process, if it's to your right to travel, if it's whatever you're saying your right is, the U.S., which is an artificial entity, has already made a claim that you didn't have those rights.
Teach more.
They say you have privileges, right? Mm-hmm. So they already put a claim in the system that you didn't have these rights. Mm-hmm. So now for you to say that you do have this right, and you declare this right to be one with you, you have to sue them back for that right. Mm-hmm. You have to allow them to challenge you on that right. So don't get discouraged and get mad and ask, well, why they're challenging me? Why they're saying that they disagree with me? Why they don't accept what I'm saying? That's court in the law. You have to expect to be challenged. You know how many people I've encountered to say, you know, that stuff don't work. And, you know, I went down and they said this, they said that, and you know, I ain't trying to deal with all that. And that's your prerogative. But what I'm saying to you, I'm laying down the law, is don't take it personal. Everybody had to go through that. And really, that's the challenge and that's the foe that man must fight. That's a foe. And the record tells us without the foe, the soldier is never going to know his strength. So he said thought must be developed by the exercising of the strength. So you got to exercise this claim of right. It's not going to come to you. You have to, metaphysically and spiritually, you have to work on reversing those sinful ways of action. And until you do that, the people within the state that you live, in the government, which is the people, they're not going to recognize your claim of freedom until they see that you have started to work on reversing that sin. And that's from a physical to a metaphysical lesson. Regardless of what they should honor because of what the Constitution say. Forget the Constitution written because you're the Constitution. And if they see that you're not one with the Constitution, meaning if you're the one that walked down there and you don't know the language of the Constitution, and like Shatik was saying, you're not in the proper attire of the nation that you're even claiming, don't expect them to honor a claim of right that you're claiming a certain nation and you're not in one with this nation. If I go down there and claim I'm Chinese, or I'm a part of the Chinese citizenship, or any of this stuff, you know, I got heirs to the Chinese estate. If I go make this claim and I don't clearly, they can't recognize nothing about me in harmony with any of the Chinese people, they're going to look at me and start laughing. Am I right? So imagine the same claim that we're making. We were out yesterday exercising, just demonstrating, all of us. You know, myself, my family, Brother Cliff, family, Brother Terrence, right? A Hindu said to Brother Terrence, he said, I haven't seen nobody wear that fez in 16 years since I left home. I can tell you multiple statements that was made yesterday, but we run into this all the time. Why? Because he was just being himself, demonstrating who he is. It wasn't out for show, just doing what we do. We was at the flea market. But the fact that other people had recognized the fez, the attire, from another tradition other than the so-called black people, he said he had been here for 16 years and ain't seen nobody wear that fez. That's bad. That's sad. But what I'm saying is they associated the headdress with a certain group of people, a certain hierarchy, a certain status. Another person said that, yeah, people in my country, they, you know, the authority wear that. So immediately what they do is associate your attire, your headdress, or your language with a certain realm of consciousness, a certain legal status. And if you have none of that with you at the time of a claim of right, then it doesn't make it right or wrong. It doesn't make it right that they do this, but they're just, 9 times out of 10, they're not going to honor your claim. So I'm just coming from that perspective for starters, just to give us some type of assistance trying to get this done. Because the object is to start proclaiming your name and your nationality, meaning getting that done, correcting the contracts that you have previously made with these European slaveholders. We have to reverse those contracts by doing business in our free national name. Casting a ballot under the state's constitution in our free national name. Whatever you engage yourself in the public, because the public is the people of the government, whatever you do in the government, you're supposed to only do under your free national name. Because that's where your protections come from.
Teach more.
You have no recourse outside of being in your proper name and nationality. You have no recourse at law. Don't mean that they just going to automatically honor you and that's it. That's not what that means. That means that if they injure you, if they injure you under your free national name, what that means is now you have constitutional recourse behind that.
Right.
That's what that means. That means that you have constitutional recourse, also due process of law, but now also you got metaphysical recourse to it. Because now you're calling on the assistance of the angelical beings and your forefathers to assist and aid you in that process of your claim and right. But if you don't honor your forefathers by name and principle, they're not going to come to your assistance in a time of need. That's a spiritual lesson.
Islam. The prophet addressed that divine born for the nation. He said that Italian, Greeks, Chinese, Japanese, Arabians are forced to proclaim their free national name. It's no more than right that all citizens of America do the same. And he says, through your free national name, you are known and recognized. So if a man is born and raised and failed to give a free national name, he is in prison, misused, exiled. These things, these conditions are happening to us. Because we don't understand that, you know, we're going under substantial rights, which is the right for every citizen under Article 4, Section 2. But you also have, like the grants you talked about, the metaphysical rights, which is the right given to you by your great God Allah, which you're calling inalienable rights. But without your religious aims and belief, which we call moral standards, we have no protection at all. Islam.
And I know time is running down, but this is very important. So timeline has a lot to do with government, meaning knowing your history. as we measure time by cycle ages. So understanding the events that took place, the years that they took place, has a lot to do with a claim of right. Because when they challenge you, they're going to know when, where, and how. Remember those three questions. So when is part of the time period, the year. Like Drew Ali hit on with 1865, you said you dead at that issue. So that's just a quick reference to how timeline on point dealing with mathematics, you're supposed to know that. So when they ask you when, you're supposed to know what dates did what. That way that that's a claim. It was a claim into the record in 1865, is what I'm saying. And what you're doing is making reference to a claim someone else made. You can do that. They call that case law. And in court, that's really a lot of the communication that's going on. It's hard to win a case in court without case law.
Common law.
That's what they want to hear. Well, was this argued before? You know, what was the verdict? What was the ruling on that? How was it interpreted in court? That's what they want to know, because that's the system. And remember, he said you're going to keep these Europeans here, what? Long enough to teach us some government stuff. Right? So therefore, you got to really know what they know. And then go beyond what they know. But you got to first know what they know. So you got to look at how they argue case. If you was an intern, and you going to school to be an attorney or whatever, or judge or whatever, be a part of the bar, before part of your instructions in your schooling period, as an intern, you have to go sit in on court cases on all different levels, from municipal to federal. And you got to go take notes, do homework. They might assign you to a certain case and say, yeah, well, you know, it's a murder case going on over here, whatever. Yeah. Your job is to go sit in on that case and take notes, and you're going to be quizzed on that case. This is every internship. People got to go through that. And this is how they learn law. So they have to go. They got to say what cases was spoke about, what was entered into the record. They got to know all of this. They got to know the ins and out of every avenue of that. So do we. Don't take this lightly as Moors. We supposed to do that too. Don't wait for instructions or someone to force you to do these things. This is common study and knowledge of an adept, of a serious Moorish American. These are things you must do. Go to the law library, do studies, do homework, go down and view cases, study case law. Librarians, this is what they do. Law librarians. They have to be learned in case law to a certain degree, at least from a directory point of view. Because when interns and people and lawyers and attorneys, paralegals, what they do is when they go to the law library, they're going there to search a certain case. Could have been the Dred Scott case, the 1860s. They might be going there to do research on that. So when they go there, they go to the law library and says, I need everything you got on the Dred Scott case, 1857, right? So the law librarian, she got to know exactly the indexes or where that's at.
Right.
So they can assist that individual. So they got to be educated on that. Regular librarians, not so much. But when you get into the law libraries, they're well learned in these areas. So you have to, you should even know who's your head law librarian in your local community. Because as an active Moor, you should already been down there, and they should be familiar with you and the whole thing. But that's, once again, another line. Most of them are Masons or Eastern Stars for certain reasons. So in 1865, going back to 1863 timeline, let's deal with 1863 first. You have what was referred to as the Emancipation Proclamation, January 1st, 1863. That's landmark. Every Asiatic here in North America should know that. Just know the ins and outs of that. The prophet made reference to that as a case law. He's not riding on that act 100%, but he is making reference to it because he's holding them accountable to their obligation, to something that they agreed to. Because law is based on contracts. All right, so Emancipation Proclamation was a contract. It was an agreement that was entered into the record that they all eventually agreed to, where they had to end their practice of slavery. Mm-hmm. And according to that, there were certain terms and conditions that each state that was a party to this union had to agree to. Did they stop? No. But they said that they were going to stop. They made vow and obligation to stop. So what they did was they stopped a form of slavery. Slavery as it was being practiced at that time. But what they did was they came up with more strategic ways to continue slavery under other practices. So now if you don't know how the change of practices took place from generation to generation, then you won't really identify slavery and what they should do and what they're not supposed to do. This is why even in the questionnaire teach you a lot. Is that name some of the marks that was put upon the Moors in 1774 by the European slaveholder. But he said some of the marks. Those were just some of the marks identified back in that time period. He said in 1774. If I said to you right now, name some of the marks that was put upon you in the 1990s, or in 2005 to 2010, or 2014, every time I go through a bracket of years, you should be able to give me some marks within those time frames, because they keep hitting you with new marks. You see what I'm saying? And even our own people start hitting us with marks. The Europeans ain't the only ones that we got to be aware of now that's giving us marks. Our own people are giving us marks. Celebrities, rappers are giving us marks that we're agreeing to. And we don't understand that they're working for the European. That's another lesson.
Teach more.
We're just dealing with the emancipation. You have a question?
No.
Islam. So very quickly, running this down. I just want to define to you emancipation. Everybody knows what that means, right? All right. But just reiterating the legal ramification of emancipated. The act by which one was unfree or under the power and control of another is rendered free. Remember, it's an act. It's an act. An act is a point of law. So it's just not, someone can say emancipated means to make free or to be free. That's generally speaking, but that's not really what it means. It was an act. Just like Prophet hit you with Act 1, Act 2, was an action to be done. Same thing with emancipation. It was an act. It was an order to be done. Meaning that whoever you considered unfree needs to be free now. That's what that means. That's what took place, rather. So it was an act by which one was unfree, which who was unfree or under the power or control of another, which means slavery, is rendered free or set at liberty and made his own master. You understand that? So this is where master and servant comes in at. Either one or the other. If you're free and possess sovereignty, then you are a master. You're a self-master. Master over self. The term is principally used with reference to the emancipation of a minor child by his parents, which involves an entire surrender of the right to the care, custody, and earnings of such child, as well as renunciation of parental duties. The emancipation may be expressed or as by voluntary agreement of parent and child, or implied from such acts of conduct as import consent, and it may be conditional or absolute, complete or partial. Emancipation Proclamation. That's just the term emancipation. And also certain acts that also took place with that, dealing with the parental rights and stuff like that. And also, and that's another lesson that Moors need to understand, because we don't have true ownership or parental rights over our children.
Jeez, man.
Because if we are property, property can't own property. Therefore, if your children is your property, which is supposed to be so, if you are property yourself, then you don't own your children. So this is where it was breaking down, even in emancipation. This is what minority is considered. Their children are what they call state property. This is why we have to understand this. So when we start bearing seeds and stuff like that, children, that we must do things correctly from day one, so we don't enter them into this contract where we have partial ownership over our children. Because if we have partial ownership over our children, then that means that we gave the state an interest in our children. So now the state within its respective agencies can come in and say and do what they want to our children. And don't tell me it's not occurring. So these are issues that's paramount and priority that, you know, we as serious Moors have to deal with these issues every day.
Yes.
You know, we deal with these every day. So, once again, if you don't, you might be an individual who don't have children. So it might not be your immediate concern, but don't look at it that way. You understand? Because we all one family. So what they do to your children, they doing to my children and vice versa. And we got an obligation to each other. And united we stand, and divided we fall. Islam?
Islam.
Sister Mama.
I was just going to say, a friend of mine just was going through that with court for his daughter, who's having his daughter emancipated. Is that what that means, what you're saying?
Yes, but once again, once you go into statutory law or state statutes and codes, then they got modern day codes and language that they use in reference to all of that. So you still can't be unconscious and follow their procedure of what they call emancipation or what they call changing your name. Because, yeah, like, they got forms and applications and templates already laid out for you. Mm-hmm. You want to take suit, then they can say, okay, if you want to be a pro se litigant, here you go.
Right.
Form is right here.
Yeah.
So don't be fooled by what they're saying their assistance is or what they have provided for you. And that's the psychology that, once again, we keep allowing the slaveholders to set the rules for us to be free. And why would it be into their best interest to show you the true way for you to really be free? Stop it. Just in general. We got to really come up off of that. If someone is unconscious and they're following that method, that's what bringing them the truth about their nationality and birthright really is. If you're not bringing that to them, you're not doing them any justice. You're doing them an injustice. And you will be liable for, according to law, spiritual law, for that. That's back to what we were speaking about earlier. You know, you keep toiling out to follow. We can't come here. Like, you, this could be your first day here, even hearing any of this. Just say if it is. You've been told today about certain things that can start you on another path. If you go back and disregard any of this, don't do no research, and still continue to engage in these other contracts and deal with this folly, then you're going to be charged for that. And if that European don't charge you, then Allah is going to charge you. So beware of that. Islam.
A good example that we can reflect upon in this day and time is what's going on in the Ferguson case. These people are arguing, you know, freedom of press, you know, under civil rights, which is contradictory. Because the freedom of press only comes through your traditions and customs of the manner in which you and your forefathers were raised on. So when we see that the laws that... It's like an oxymoron. How can you fight for religious freedom or the right to do anything when you have no rights? So when they afford you due process and don't explain what that due process is, that's unclear.
You know what I'm saying? We're fighting for, like Grancy just said, the proof is in the pudding. Until we obligate ourselves to the national standards which is going to protect us through the First Amendment, we have no protection at all. And this is what we see when we see the people in St. Louis arguing for due process, but yet they're still considered Negro, Black, Cousin, Ethiopian, just based off the treatment that they're receiving.
That's long. Back to what I said earlier about recourse. That's what the advantage of having a free national name and being a part of a free nation does for you. It gives you recourse so that you can now challenge these things with a equal footing. Now the law can come to your aid because you have harmonized with the law. But if you have not done that, then the law cannot be on your side. And this is what it means, you have no recourse. And this is what he's saying about the Ferguson case or any other Asiatic that's injured and is going to court, or what we call railroaded and discriminated against. All of these things we use because it's in the book. And we say, oh, that's discrimination. Oh, that's not right. That's not just. We say all of these things. But if we are not in the proper status and have not proclaimed and answered up to constitutional law, then you can't call it discrimination. And you have no recourse to that discrimination outside of what they call civil rights. And civil rights was instituted by the civil rights after 1983 is a category of codes and that they call laws that was put for you for slaves, I should say, as a recourse for slaves. That's not the civil rights that we are attracted to or harmonized with. You got to understand this. So what I'm really saying to you is this. You have to have recourse in order to even challenge a claim or either what they call counterclaim. That means if somebody put a claim on you, you're trying to counterclaim it now. That's how they reverse it. You go sue a European right now. I don't care what it's for. What he going to do is counterclaim. Why? Because that's the protocol. Because he already in harmony with law. That's what they do. If I sue you and you go get an attorney talking about he's suing me, the attorney going to say, well, you need to counterclaim. Because that's how you challenge his claim, is by counterclaiming. And what we're saying is, if you haven't proclaimed, you haven't counterclaimed the claims that was put on you that you Negro, Black, and colored.
Peace, man.
Yes, sir.
I just would like to add that as in the Ferguson case, as in all of the other abuses that has happened here recently, the reason why they can't get no retribution for it is because they're still an African American, Negro, Black, or colored, which summarizes it all in one sum. They're still outside of the constitutional fold. So this is why they're able to allow it to just go on and on and on, while the people just get like emotional. Because you don't know the law, you don't know your constitutional self. You have, as a grand chief said, you have no recourse.
Islam. Very important as well. Just bear with me. I know we're getting a little impatient here. Emancipation Proclamation. An executive proclamation. Remember, an executive proclamation. Declaring that all persons held in slavery in certain designated states and districts were and should remain free. It was issued January 1st, 1863 by Abraham Lincoln as President of the United States and Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces. Now listen to this. That's the term Emancipation Proclamation. This is Black's Law Dictionary, 3rd edition. Right? General knowledge, you should have one. Moore asked me the other day. Moore, you know, people keep arguing, going back and forth about, are we part and parcel or are we part and partial? You know, what's accurate? So once again, when you study, you will know the answer to these. So I'm going to show you something to help you understand what position the Prophet intended for us. This is a term partial emancipation. So if emancipation means to set free in general, then listen to what partial emancipation means. I mean, you pretty much can sum it up, but this is a legal term. That which frees a child for only a part of the period of minority, or from only a part of the parent's rights. Back to your question, or your statement that you made. Or for some purposes and not for others. Because that's what partial means. So how are you going to be part and partial of this said government? What does that mean if you partial of this government? That means that you have some rights of the government and some you don't. Is that equal?
No.
So it's a contradiction, right? Just like I said, basic. Man knows not by being told. So man has to do some research and come one with what he knows. So that's just something quick, just to throw out there real quick. So in brief, the Emancipation Proclamation was declared for so-called Negroes to be set at liberty. But we are not Negroes black in color, right? Abraham Lincoln did what he can do. He did a lot. But he still had to code a lot of things that he did. So everything wasn't secure and perfected in 1863 or 1865 when he did his Emancipation Proclamation. So if you listen to the prophet, that's why he said this is the reason why Allah ordained Noble Jew Ali to come here, because it wasn't complete. If the Asiatics were set free, then it wouldn't have been no need for Jew Ali to come on the scene, because it would have been done. Understand? We wouldn't have had no more issues of Negro, black, colored, slavery, anything. We'd have been constitutionalists and everything would have been restored. But because it didn't restore everything, Allah sent Noble Jew Ali to the Asiatics of North America to restore it, to secure it, to make sure it was a done deal this time. You understand that? Islam, brother.
Islam. So was Abraham Lincoln Emancipation Proclamation done intentionally not to fully free the slaves? Like some things was left out to intentionally keep them?
Well, good question. And that's what I meant, that he did the best he could.
Yeah,
because, for example, he intentionally was trying to do that. He set a standard that was to be complete at a later date. Within the Emancipation Proclamation itself, it didn't express the full intent. Because if he would have done that, then it wouldn't have even got any momentum to be passed. And if it's a great movie, that movie they did with about him, the Abraham Lincoln movie. Look it over again, and look it over a couple times. But he had a lot of opposition in even trying to get that emancipation passed, that proclamation passed, on the level that it did express. So it was something to be done in stages. And so he kind of had to, like the prophet said, go around his elbow to get to his thumb. He had to kind of like trick his constituents to actually get momentum to even pass that. So what he did was planted a seed, but it wasn't fully holding within itself the full potential of what he was trying to do. And this is why when they caught wind of really what he was trying to do, they wasn't going to let him get any more momentum, and that's why they took him out. So it wasn't meant within the first proclamation in order, and even within, let me back up, you had the proclamation and also you had the oath of amnesty. So he was doing it in stages. Once the proclamation was passed, he came out with the oath to amnesty. And the oath to amnesty is in harmony with my lesson, really coming full circle. Because now that part two of the Emancipation Proclamation was once these so-called people were referred to as Negroes, once they was emancipated, and this was an act that had to be acknowledged, they didn't automatically get this recognition of being free. What they had to do next was they had to take an oath of amnesty, which is a proclamation to be free and set at liberty. That means that they had declared their freedom, and they had to do it within what they call an oath of amnesty, which states within that oath that they're taking an oath to defend and support the Constitution of the United States. And also part of that is they had to ask for a pardon, like apologizing for their sinful ways of action and their sinful acts of being outside the constitutional law, because slavery is outside constitutional law. So being that they was considered slaves, they had to apologize to the government for even being a slave or agreeing that they was a slave. And that's what they call a pardon. So they had to ask for a pardon and now say, well, pardon self for my previous ways of action as being Negro, Black, and colored. I'm now declaring that I am not Negro, Black, or colored, or I'm not a slave. And I'm also, within that, taking an oath to declare myself or to take a vow to defend the Constitution of the United States of America. Because Abraham Lincoln understood that until you declare your allegiance to the Constitution of the United States, you cannot be considered a citizen of the United States. So even since 1865, the only way under the new administration, the new era of time, you had to declare your allegiance to the United States Constitution in order to be considered a citizen of the United States. And to this day, the people lost that concept because they took him out where no one really picked up on it and enforced his acts. I'm talking about Lincoln's acts. So because there was not really the agenda of no one else outside of Lincoln at that time, because they took him out, there was nobody who really picked up the torch and really pursued his agenda. So even though it was an act in law, they kind of like swept it under the rug and said, well, you know what, we don't really have to go by that. Let's do it this way. Boom, 14th Amendment for you. This is how we're going to do things. So they came out with the 14th Amendment to really override what Lincoln did. And this is why Allah had to say, well, look, they came out with this 14th Amendment. I got to do something about this. So this is where he sent Drew Ali to the scene to camelback off of what Lincoln did, dealing with that oath of amnesty. The Prophet just didn't word it oath of amnesty and Emancipation Proclamation. He came out with his own language towards it and said, and also added to what really needs to be done according to international law, and said, look, we need to proclaim our free national name. We need to proclaim our nationality. And through that, in the procedure, in the process, in the language of it, through that, in the religious concepts, aims, objects, etc., we're going to be known and recognized by this whole package deal here. You understand? So Lincoln couldn't do that because it wasn't meant for him to do that. He couldn't represent us like that. That wasn't his job. It was the Prophet's job, because the Prophet is truly a representative of a nation. So we needed a Prophet to complete this package on what really needed to be done for a nation that was debased down to that state. A Prophet, a true and divine Prophet, is the only one that can actually do that, according to law. And that's what was sent to us. So in the process of that proclaiming our free national name or proclaiming our nationality, he did it in harmony with constitutional law and international law. And this is what we have before us today. This is what we came out with through years of an investigation and things of that. We put it into proper perspective. And within our affidavits, because the affidavit means an affirmation of truth, means this is your claim to the public in writing. I declare is what you're saying in this affidavit. This is your claim of right, that you're entering into the record and telling these people that you're not Negro, Black, or color, you're not a slave, you're not that straw man, you're not an artificial person, the whole nine, you know what we say. It's all rabbled into this affidavit. You have to put this on record in order to satisfy the lawful requirements of not just the Emancipation Proclamation, but also the Oath to Amnesty, also the Divine Constitution and international records. This is the way it's done. It's not the only way it's done, but according to the Prophet's lessons and teachings, this is our interpretation of what has to be done. What we need to understand is everybody don't do this. Even Moors are the Moors. You got Moors because Moors are brilliant and Moors find ways to do things. You got Moors according to their understanding, according to their teachings, they do things different ways. But regardless of what way you do it, the universal way is you got to put a claim in writing and put that claim on the record. Record means filing. If you don't have something that looks like this, it could be one document, it could be several, all according to who you're dealing with. But if you don't have something similar to this on the public record, then you have not proclaimed your nationality. And part two to that is not just having it on the record, but once it's on the record, you take that to all of these other agencies of the U.S. corporation and let them know that this is how you're doing business now. Don't refer to me as John Smith anymore because that's not who I am. I've challenged John Smith and the government agreed. This is who I am and this is who I will be and this is who I evermore will be. Until you do that and get them to join or agree to your terms and conditions, then you have a challenge. Because they're going to challenge you. Let me see who signed that. Where was this file? Did you do a name change through the court? And what you got to understand is you didn't do a name change. You proclaimed your nationality. That holds more weight than you doing a name change. If you're doing a name change, then you got to go to the court. You got to go to Common Pleas or Justice of the Peace or Superior Court and do that. That's for a name change. Under this modern day jurisdiction, before you can just do what they call a common law name change and you didn't have to do that. But nowadays, if you're a corporate or artificial entity on paper, you have to go to them to get permission to change your name. So you got to have the judge sign off on that. But if you proclaiming your free national name and your nationality and your religion, you can't go to the court and do that because they don't do that. They don't have a procedure for you to do that. So they can't force you to go somewhere to do something that there is no process to do that. So a lot of Moors get turned around and say, well, they said I got to go to the court and get that done. And I question them, okay, well, you tell me what court does that, and I'll go with you. But you can't do that because don't no court do that. Yeah, they'll change your name, but they're not proclaiming your nationality. They don't have jurisdiction to do that. So how can you even, and for Moors to go there and ask them to do that, look what you're doing, is you're competent. Because you're asking them to do something that they don't have jurisdiction to do, and they can't do, and they don't want to do, and they will not do. So why are you even asking them to do something that's unconstitutional? Constitution even tell you they can't do that. State can't grant any title of nobility. So how you gonna ask them to put an L or a Bay on your name, which is a title of nobility, and the Constitution said that they can't do that? So by asking them, it's showing them that you don't know the law. So they gonna mess with you. They gonna say, you know what? You know, just for trying to make an effort to get out my system, and you don't know what you're talking about, I'm gonna make it harder for you. So don't go that route. If you going, you know, like slave, you know, back to the plantation talk, like Harriet Tubman told him, if you going to run, you got to run. You can't say you running, but you walking, because you going to get shot down very quickly. You understand? So when you can come here all you want, and they don't know what you're doing, because it's private in here. But you enter something into that record, they know what you're doing. And that's an example of running. If you're going to do that, then you got to run. You got to run totally away from that plantation. You got to cut communication, association, and contractual agreement with them under that straw man. They only got jurisdiction over the straw man. They don't have jurisdiction over your free national name. You got to quickly correct that straw man to that free national. Then you can go back and play with them in the system once you got your free national name, because they can't, they don't have jurisdiction over that. But as long as you're still trying to play with them under that straw man fictitious name, they got leave over that. And when they see that, then they're going to exercise their leave, or what they call, they're going to exercise their jurisdictional discretion.
Islam. That's beautiful that you said that, because going back to chapter 43, chapter 43 speaks about the matter of the subject. And it says that how many evils have committed by the convenience of the law? How many crimes committed by the decree of the council? Remember, this affidavit creates, a resolution. A resolution means a remedy for you. But if they're passing legislation to keep you from doing that, then it tells you, and I read it in my lesson, inconstancy and instability. It says, they who gave the body furnished with weakness, but he who gave your soul, which is conscious, armed with resolution. He said, but beware of the intent. Let me read it for the record. It says, beware of the irresolution, which means when you say a resolutionary, you don't have a solution. It said, beware of the resolution and intent of their actions, and beware of the instability in the execution of it. So when they execute or pass these legislation, even though they're passing these legislation, they're not looking at you in regards to giving you due process, because their intent is not to give you due process. Like the question the brother just asked in regards to Abraham Lincoln. He did the best way he could, but he knew himself, even in the passing of the magistrate and substance or the rulers or the statesmen, that they were passing legislation that was unconstitutional.
Time to close? It's not, man.
Even though it's colored, even when someone gets naturalized, comes here from a different country, becomes a quote-unquote citizen, we still make them take an oath to protect the Constitution. Mm-hmm. So even then, like you said in the divine warning, the Arabians, Turks, such and such,
forced to proclaim their free national names, no more than right than being forced on anybody like Islam. I'm closing. Islam, but I'm a petition this. The reason why is y'all have to give me more time to do these lessons. Y'all want me to do these lessons, you gotta give me more time.
Right.
I cannot compile my lessons into these small time periods.
I cut my time short after all this.
No, I mean, I'm not going to overdo it. I'm just saying that, seriously speaking, we have to adjust it some type of way.
Right.
Islam. If not, because it's pertinent stuff that needs to go over that I'm trying to speed through it, and it's only going to depreciate us as a whole. Community and our online viewers because of that. But these are issues very, very quickly that we need to look at. We give you pamphlets like the rights of indigenous people, constitution, and certain stuff with your membership, right? Here. You gotta really read this stuff because it helps you challenge these claims that's out here. And very quickly, if you go to Article 22 of the Declaration of Human Rights, and it's in the Rights of Indigenous People book, it says everyone as a member of society has the right to social security and is entitled to the realization through national effort and international cooperation and in accordance with the organization and resources of each state. Of the economic and social and cultural rights indispensable for his dignity and his free development of his personality. So this is how you got to be able to strategy. You got to be able to use laws and things to your advantage when you're producing these claims. That's also something like a case law you can use. But Social Security, some people say, well, don't use it, get rid of it. You know, that's going to put us back in the system. You got to understand it doesn't. What it does if you're accepting Social Security under a privileged status and a privileged name. Remember, Larry Smith is what they refer to as a Christian name. It's a slave name in the sense that it's a user's name. It's a franchise name that was given to you for corporate activity. Its intent is to be an artificial entity because it's not you, it's a colorable name. Therefore, if you, whatever benefits you receive under that colorable name does not really belong to you, it belongs to whoever possesses that name, the family that possesses his name. So this is how the slaveholder still had his slavery interest in the people after 1863, because it came up with all these ways where they can still practice slavery without so-called saying they practice in slavery. Anything you do, if you go to work, you've got what they call working papers under these names, that means that these are not rights for you to vote. I mean work. These are not rights for you to vote. These are not rights that people are bound to respect. There's no rights with that. They're privileges at that point because it's not your name to begin with. So if I give you a name to use but really ain't yours, then that means if I own the name, I own whatever possession comes with that. So that's what occurs with these names. But it even tells you within the Human Rights Article, as long as you have your cultural ties to that, it becomes a right that's entitled to you under the Constitution. But now you can use Constitution as a recourse if they claim anything else. But if you're still in another name, then you don't have no constitutional recourse. And that's kind of like the same thing with state identification, driver's license, whatever they give you. As being a free national, you're entitled to whatever the state gives its citizens and its corporate citizens. You're still entitled to it, especially if they say that they only accept this ID as ID, or this instrument for traveling on the land. They only accept this, and this is what we give our citizens. If that's the case, you being a free national, they have to give that to you as free passage on the land, because it's the only thing that their agents accept. So Moore's got to understand that just because you accept that instrument don't mean that you're a corporate slave now, or you water the state because you have that instrument. They even said that they have to give it to you. It's your option to take it, and you can take it without being obligated to that artificial entity. That's why when you accept it, you must reserve your rights with the UCC code on it to let them know that this document, meaning you just use a driver's license, say if I got a driver's license in my possession. They say, oh, well, because you got a driver's license, you are a ward of the state. Or you are a member of the UDOT, whatever they want to say. I can simply say, I never agreed to that. In fact, if you look at it, flip it around, or look at the signature, is a reservation on rights there with a UCC code 1-103, which simply states that this instrument has to be construed in harmony with the common law. Which means now, I just took this artificial instrument that is under statutory regulation and made it a common law document.
Peace, Mom.
Especially with my free national name and my attire, my headdress on this instrument, I just made it a common law document. Now they have to view it that way. They're not going to tell their other citizens that, but because you're an exception, they have to view and regulate you different from how they would view the other citizens. Just because you reworded and changed the contract itself. But if you have not changed the contract, then you're still obligated to the old terms.